When people talk about love, they are generally talking about romantic love, as it seems to be the kind that most people associate with the word. But this is kind of odd. Romantic love is not the only kind of love that one can experience, and in fact, it may even be the least common. There are many types of love that one can experience, like a kind of love you have for your very best friends, or a kind of love that you have for your pets. The topic of this Toradora arc is familial love, or the kind of love that one has for their family, and it asks whether one's biological family is entitled to that kind of love. This aspect of the arc comes into focus when Taiga is ignoring calls from her father and makes some rather harsh comments at his expense. Now, we're used to seeing Taiga get aggressive. Hell, we've seen her act needlessly aggressive towards Ryuji in this very episode. But there's something different about her attitude towards her father. While her aggression towards Ryuji and her other classmates come from a place of insecurity, the aggression she showcases towards her father suggests genuine disdain and contempt. Ryuji becomes a counterpoint to this attitude, stating that Taiga's father deserves the respect that one would normally afford their father. No matter how awful he was to you, he's still your dad, Ryuji says, trying to give Taiga helpful advice, like the time he told her that beans were the meat of the garden, or the time he explained what laminating was. Except there's something fundamentally different about this advice. Unlike the previously mentioned examples, in this scenario, Ryuji is wrong. Yeah, I know, way to give away the answer to the arc's ultimate question at the start, but frankly, I cannot see a way to give this arc the analysis it deserves without getting this out of the way from the start. Is one's biological family entitled to familial love? No. However, the arc is not solely about answering this question, but rather the conflict it creates, why Ryuji is so passionate about this viewpoint, and what ultimately leads him to admit that he is wrong. Taiga begins this arc with an attitude that her father does not deserve her love. I would argue that the aggression she showcases is somewhat forced in an ongoing effort to keep the fire of her rage alight. This is because, in a way, she wants her father to be a part of her life. She wants him to be there for her, but she knows that if she gives him that chance, he will hurt her again like he had the previous year. So she forces an aggressive attitude to protect herself, but this becomes far more difficult when she suddenly needs to be on guard around Ryuji as well. Ryuji begins this arc firmly believing that one's biological family is entitled to familial love despite any wrongdoings. When he meets Taiga's father, he unwittingly becomes his pawn, buying into his supposed redemption and missing the obvious manipulation that he had used. Ryuji becomes a messenger for Taiga's father and fulfills that role rather well, to the point that Taiga sees it as a betrayal of sorts. "You should feel sorry for me," she yells, as the enemy of her emotional battle has just been joined by her most valuable ally. These differing ideologies do cause conflict between Taiga and Ryuji, ending with an intense climax that is so well executed that I will once again be going in depth. After Taiga physically assaults her father as an ultimate deterrent from staying around, Ryuji grabs her by the wrist and accuses her of being stubborn. This is certainly a trait that Taiga expresses consistently, and over trivial matters at that, but it doesn't occur to Ryuji that she might have a valid reason to be stubborn this time. Taiga bites back by deriding Ryuji for taking her father's side, saying that he is supposed to be on hers. As I said before, Taiga's fight is more based on her own emotions, trying to fight her instinct to fall for her father's old tricks again. And the fact that Ryuji, of all people, is fighting against her in that regard tears her up. Ryuji, unaware of the real struggle that Taiga is facing, claims that he is on her side, that all she needs to do is talk to her father and she will understand what he believes her father's motivations to be. What strikes me about this just give him another chance approach from Ryuji is that it is likely what Taiga is thinking as well, against her better judgment. Of course she wants to give him a chance, she wants him to change into a more reliable father figure. But again, he cannot be trusted to be that person. She fights these thoughts with aggression, doubling down on the insults for her father, but this just makes Ryuji even more mad. He pins her against the wall, physically restraining her to ensure that she hears what he has to say, and he says something that really gets under Taiga's skin. "Don't you want to go home?" This gets to Taiga because ultimately the answer is yes. In fact, that is all she has ever wanted. to belong somewhere, to be loved. This is her main motivation for liking Kitamura, and it is this desire that will drive her to melt down in the Christmas arc. And here Ryuji is, using her most intimate desire against her. It's important to note that Ryuji genuinely believes that he is doing the right thing, that this really will solve all her problems, and Taiga hasn't done anything to help him understand why he is wrong about that. But Ryuji is still acting out of a pretty powerful bias that he will realize the existence of soon. Taiga makes one last attempt to resist the temptation of returning to her father. She tells Ryuji that she threw him away because he is trash, a statement that she needed to hear even more than Ryuji did to maintain her anger and remind herself that her father cannot be trusted. But Ryuji isn't budging. He ends his own part of the argument by bringing up his own father. My old man is never coming back, no matter how much I want. It hits him at that moment that he has a pretty strong bias in this situation. Taiga's father coming to rejoin her life is a dream scenario for Ryuji, one that he wants for himself. So he begins to wonder if this strong emotional response is really for Taiga's sake or just a product of his bias. This is why Ryuji fundamentally agrees with the love your family no matter what mentality, because he knows what it's like to have a broken family, so he cannot comprehend why someone who has the chance for an unbroken family wouldn't take it. The revelation is too late, however. He has accomplished what he set out to do. As he goes to apologize, Taiga concedes the battle, with him and with herself. She says that she will give him a chance. Not only does she say that it's for the best, vocalizing the other side of the conflict she had been having within herself, but she also says that she'll do it because Ryuji thinks it's the right thing to do, placing some responsibility of this reunion onto Ryuji. The episode ends with Taiga giving her father that chance and completely giving in to her desire for a family. Despite having realized his own bias, Ryuji still believes that Taiga's father deserves that second chance, and will continue to support them, despite knowing that his motivation for maintaining this mindset is extremely personal. By the time we get to the second episode, Taiga's father has become a part of her life again, constantly meeting her after school, taking her out to dinner, and just generally being around. Taiga tries to keep some semblance of a guard up to protect herself in case he disappears again, but ultimately she is too far gone in that regard. This becomes most apparent when she asks Ami to switch roles in their upcoming school play, so that her father can see her perform with a better role. The dynamic of a parent coming to watch a kid perform in a school play is a cliché that the show indulges in, but it's a cliché that's used appropriately, as it uses a story element we are all familiar with to draw out the emotions that this kind of story usually brings out, only to have it contrasted with the devastation we will feel when this cliché is subverted. Despite having won over Taiga, Ryuji isn't finished defending his position on whether Taiga's father deserves a second chance. We are brutally reminded of this with the argument between him and Minori. Minori shows the same kind of attitude that Taiga had last episode, to be openly hostile and aggressive, a stark contrast to her usual cheerful self. She ends the argument with a rather nasty implication. Do your dad eyes even work? Implying that someone without a father like Ryuji could easily be blinded to the truth about somebody else's. Now, while this does further tie into why Ryuji's attitude is to respect one's father no matter what, this comment from Minori is still downright cruel, and I'm glad that she apologizes for it later. Sometime after, Ryuji is confronted with yet another person who thinks that Taiga's father is bad news, his mother Yasu. She says that it seems selfish for him to just appear out of nowhere and take Taiga away, referencing the fact that Taiga's father has plans to move her out of her neighboring apartment. Ryuji goes to aggressively defend his own position, but is defused by Yasu's confused look. In this more calm state, he is forced to listen to what Yasu has to say. She's part of our family now. This line sets up the last of the dominoes to be knocked over for the big reveal, that after all the fighting and arguing with people he cared about most, Ryuji sees firsthand that he was wrong, that Taiga's father truly is the scumbag that Taiga made him out to be, and he should have never been trusted. He sees in hindsight that the meetings her father organized, the payments he gave her, it was all on his terms. He only ever did what was convenient for him, and now that something else has come up, he is once again abandoning his daughter without even telling her to her face. This feeling of dread is amplified when Tiger, up on stage, is expecting to hear her father in the crowd, but she hears nothing. Ryuji and Minori work together to change the atmosphere of the room, from one of isolation to one of unanimous support by getting everyone in the audience to cheer. While they succeed in creating this atmosphere, Ryuji realizes that it isn't enough, that she's still alone, hearkening back to the first arc when he told her, "I can't just leave you alone like that." There she is, all by herself, and as someone who is partly responsible for this situation, Ryuji feels obligated to fix it. He gets his chance to do so in the Mr. Lucky Man race, in which he uses his intimidating appearance to his advantage and becomes the aggressive kind of person that people had always feared he was. His determination to be by Tiger is so great that it negates his desire to be socially accepted. Ryuji and Minori try so hard to win this race because they want Tiger to know that, father or no father, she has a family in them. Just like Yasu said, if anyone else wins this race, it will be no better than having the school clap for her. An impersonal gesture from a stranger. That's why it has to be Ryuji or Minori, people who value the person she is and with whom she shares familial love. A point is reached where Minori sacrifices herself to make sure that Ryuji can win, conceding that if she can just ensure that Tiger has him, that's enough for her. But despite her declaration that Ryuji must go on without her, he doesn't. Instead, he takes her by the hand and finishes the race with her, making it clear that Tiger still needs both of them. While this is happening, we get an internal monologue from Tiger, wherein she says that she doesn't need anyone's help to recover, that she can come back from this on her own. What stands out to me is how often she repeats these similar sentences while gleefully watching her closest friends go to so much effort for her. To be blunt, Tiger is lying to herself. She can't recover from this or achieve her ultimate goal on her own. She needs help, just like every other character does. This individualist attitude does come back to haunt her a few times throughout the show, but for now, just keep in your mind that Tiger is lying to herself. And so the story arc ends with Tiger, Ryuji, Minori, Kitamura, and Ami all celebrating the end of the Culture Festival, putting their ulterior motives aside to have fun. Now, in viewing this arc, I can't help but notice the way it reflects aspects of reality. The question must be asked, why is the attitude of you have to love your family no matter what such a popular one in the real world? Just a heads up, this next part is going to discuss some pretty serious topics like neglect and abuse. If you're not comfortable with that, the analysis is more or less over, so you might want to leave now. Thank you very much for watching, and I will see you next time. But for those of you who want to stick around, let's get into it. For starters, you have to love your family is the type of thing that you might say to a very small child who says that they hate a parent or a sibling over some trivial matter. Sure, when kids are at an age where they know words like hate, but don't understand their true weight, it would be easy to give them a general rule that they can easily understand. But as you grow up, that kind of lesson becomes less relevant. As you come to understand the weight of hating someone or wanting them out of your life, you tend to stop using those terms over trivial wrongdoings. But what happens when those wrongdoings aren't trivial? What happens when a family member is abusive or neglectful? That lesson no longer applies. Now, the assumption that this attitude comes from childhood lessons that were held onto for too long is an optimistic one, but I don't think that's actually what makes it such a popular outlook. Instead, I believe this outlook comes from the type of family members who don't deserve to be loved or respected as figures of authority, but feel entitled to it anyway. And it is unfortunately parroted by those who have no reason to believe that this kind of love or respect is earned. I myself used to believe that one must always love their family. That is until I read online accounts of abusive, neglectful, narcissistic parents that had to be cut out of the lives of their children. And in most stories like this, the families of the post writers all said something similar. You have to love your family. You have to forgive your neglectful mother. You have to give your abusive father another chance. They are your family. You have to love them no matter what. It was after finding out how terrible some family situations are that I truly reflected on my own and realized that I loved my family not because I had to, but because they had earned my love and respect through years of support, camaraderie, and their own love for me. Sometimes I can't think of a title for an analysis until it's time to upload it. Sometimes I have to stretch the meaning of an arc to fit the alliterative title format. But The Family Fallacy was a title that I wrote down before anything else, because the attitude that one must love their family no matter what is just that, a fallacy. An argument that sounds good on paper but fails to stand up to any form of scrutiny. A non-argument used by those who don't understand how abusive people can be, who don't care how abusive people can be, or worst of all, by people who are that abusive and don't want to face any kind of consequence. Toradora is one of the few shows I can think of that sends this message, that tells you that family is who you choose and that you are under no obligation to love those who mistreat you. That your biological family is not entitled to your love or respect. That the family fallacy is one that deserves to die. And that is it for this analysis. I'd like to thank my patrons, Orion Tran, Quincy Chamberlain, Jaman5, Lars Espen, Shark, and Data52. If you'd like to support me on Patreon or join our Discord server, links for both are in the description. Thank you all very much for watching, and I will see you next time.